Hey guys, I'm John and welcome to Respect Your Intellect. I've mentioned a few times throughout my videos what got me interested in science in the first place, but one thing I didn't really touch on yet was what kept my interest in science throughout all these years, and that's getting answers to interesting questions in life that you wouldn't necessarily think to ask. So with this thought, I'm introducing a new series that we'll call Interesting Questions, where we'll explore the details of some interesting questions and get to an answer based in science. In this video, we're going to talk about how fast we would actually freeze in space and figure out if the depictions we see in movies are accurate or not. So with that said, don't forget to hit the like and subscribe buttons and let's get started! To start with, let's talk about the different factors that would come into play if we were to find ourselves instantly teleported into space without any protection. So the first thing we need to talk about is heat transfer. There are three types of ways that heat can transfer between objects. One is conduction, which is the transfer of heat between objects in direct contact. Another is convection, which is the transfer of heat within fluids, or in other words, liquids and gases. And lastly, there's radiation, which is the transfer of heat through empty space using electromagnetic waves, in other words, light. So, with empty space not having any atoms or molecules around you, there's absolutely nothing to conduct heat out of your body through conduction or convection. So all you're left with to lose heat is radiation. If you didn't already know, everything emits radiation. This is because all the atoms that make up the object are wanting to go back to a relaxed state by emitting all the energy they contain. Now, for a human being in space, this is a very, very long process, and a lot of other things can come into play. The first is whether or not that person has clothing. If they do, then there would be an exchange of radiation between the clothing and the body that could happen multiple times, and it would act as an extra layer of protection that would slow down that loss of energy to the vacuum of space. Another factor is whether you would be floating in shade or in direct sunlight. Since you lose energy through radiation very slowly, floating in space while in the shade would result in mainly losing that energy slowly and gradually. However, if you're floating in sunlight, then there's a couple of different scenarios that could happen because you're no longer just losing energy through radiation, but you're also absorbing some. So one of the possibilities here is that your body emits just a bit more energy than it receives, which would still result in you freezing, but much more slowly than our previous example in the shade. If your body emits less energy than it receives, then the opposite of freezing would happen, because you would essentially cook as you gain more and more heat. And finally, if there's an equilibrium that's reached between the amount of radiation absorbed and emitted, then you would never freeze or cook at all. In movies, we often see things like people freezing almost immediately as they start floating in space, but as you should now know, this is really not accurate. I've seen quite a few people run in-depth mathematical estimates by calculating the average human body and surface area in either shade or in sunlight and at different distances from the sun, and they reach pretty similar values. These estimates can vary between about 4 hours to freeze while in shade and not receiving any radiation at all, and up to over 24 hours when you're still receiving less energy than you're emitting. Even if those calculations aren't perfect, one thing is certain, and that's that there's absolutely no danger of freezing immediately. Instead, there are loads of other concerns that we'll talk about in just a moment. But before we do, there's one more thing to mention about movie depictions, and that's the frost on the skin. Now, this is actually something that can happen to a certain degree. You're probably already familiar with the fact that as you gain altitude on Earth, the boiling point of water gets lower and lower. This is because there's less and less atmospheric pressure pressing down on the surface of the water. While the same thing happens with the fluids in your body. We'll talk more about the inside of the body in just a moment, but for now I just want to mention the moisture on the surface of the skin. Now, as you start floating in space, every bit of humidity and moisture on your skin will immediately boil due to a complete lack of pressure. This will cause it to instantly evaporate and lose heat extremely quickly. This can result in some frost appearing on the surface of the skin, as they mostly always show in movies, though it's usually very exaggerated from what I can tell. For the amount of frost you see depicted in movies, you would probably have to be teleported into space immediately after taking a shower fully clothed. So now that we know that freezing is really not a danger to us while we're floating in space, let's talk about what else we need to really be concerned about if we were to be suddenly ejected into space. The first one we need to cover is hypoxia. This is when there's a lack of oxygen in the bloodstream and deoxygenated blood reaches the brain, resulting in a loss of consciousness. This typically happens in about 9 to 12 seconds. In 1966, there was a test performed by NASA to test a spacesuit prototype by using a massive vacuum chamber. The person inside was Jim LeBlanc, and there was a problem when his pressure hose became detached. This caused a drop in pressure to almost zero in less than 10 seconds. He was able to remain conscious for 14 seconds before becoming unconscious due to hypoxia. The last thing he remembered before losing consciousness is feeling the saliva on his tongue bubbling because it was boiling due to the lack of pressure. He was given oxygen 25 seconds after the accident happened and recovered almost immediately, with just an earache and no permanent damage. The second concern is called ebullism. This is the boiling of fluids due to a lower ambient pressure, like we just talked about with Jim's saliva boiling before he lost consciousness. So with the fluids in the body boiling and evaporating, the steam that gets created can bloat the body up to twice its normal size. In some movies, they depict this as if the body would explode, but this is very inaccurate. Our tissues are elastic enough to prevent rupture, so we would promptly return to our normal size once we're back at normal pressure. The third concern is asphyxiation, because our lungs would collapse, which would also result in hypoxia that we've already covered. Then there's incoming radiation. On Earth, we get a standard amount of radiation at sea level at all times, and that's the baseline for other measures of doses of radiation. For example, in low Earth orbit, like on the ISS, we get about 10 times the amount of standard radiation per year. With a rare event like a solar flare, it can give out fatal amounts of radiation in just minutes if you're not protected by the Earth's magnetic field. Short of that, you could also get extreme sunburns or even fatal exposures from ultraviolet radiation or even cosmic rays traveling through space. And finally, there's also always a concern for micrometeorites that could be small like grains of sand that travel through space at extreme speeds. And it doesn't sound like too much, but at those speeds, these grains of sand can go through you like a knife through butter. So to conclude, movie depictions aren't really accurate when it comes to freezing in space, and we would have much greater concerns than just freezing if it were to happen. The best chance you would have to survive is simply to exhale all the air in your lungs to prevent rapid expansion that could damage them, and then hope to be rescued within 30 seconds of exposure. Anything less usually results in an immediate recovery with no permanent damage, but anything more, and we've never been able to revive anything past that point as of yet. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I also want to thank my patrons on Patreon for supporting the channel. I really appreciate the support. If you want to see more answers to interesting questions, make sure you subscribe and click that bell notification so you don't miss out on the next videos in this series. If you have any interesting questions of your own that you've never thought to look for an answer, don't hesitate to write it down in the comments and contribute to the series. You can also check out my website at respectyourintellect.com for all the information and videos on this channel. Until next time, thanks for watching, and remember, respect your intellect.